cutest boss gift ever.
Dune jokes, they never get old.
I actually just caught that now, wow. I just found Rhythm and Mother to be generally hilarious in itself. So.
Well, it was really funny because the person she said it to was like, you know, he's maybe, I believe at least 25, and he's like, what's that mean? And so then she had to like set him up. Explain.
Oh, it's noted until quite late in the season in Charlottesville, just a couple weeks ago. Somebody at some nerd event threw it. Basically, said something about a Chris knife, and I was like, yeah, whatever. And I'm like, wait, that was a Dune joke.
There it is.
It's been like 15 years since I read that.
Yeah.
It always comes full circle.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my honor to introduce Selena Deckelmann. She's a major contributor to PostgreSQL, and she founded PyLadies PDX, Open Source Bridge, Postgres Open. Do you still keep chickens?
I do.
She still keeps chickens. So let's give her a big warm welcome. She's going to be talking about Alembic and SQLAlchemy.
Yeah, there's one that's even alive right now. It's good. Sorry. A little dead chicken humor to start off this talk. Okay, so so this talk is about database migrations and being sane about it. I uploaded the slides already, so you can check them out there. And I wanted to start out by saying thank you, and I'm sorry, to Mike Bayer, who's the primary author of Alembic, and he's here today. I think he's speaking after me, so I don't think he's here right now. And so for work, I work for Mozilla, and I work on this tool called Socorro, which is an open source crash management and business intelligence system that we run to analyze primarily Firefox crashes. You can check out our source code at that URL, and you can also see our production site that's running. And we use Alembic for all of our migrations. And while I have been at PyCon, actually, my coworkers have been running migrations all on their own, which is amazing and awesome. So as you might imagine from that introduction, we use Postgres. So most of these things, thank you, yay! I'm pretty sure that all this stuff that I'm going to talk about today would work with another database, and I know that Mike develops quite a bit for Oracle, but just to let you know that all of my experience has to do with using Alembic with Postgres. So I think the first thing to note about databases is that database systems and maybe also the people that maintain them very much resist change. And this is my idea of sort of the evolution of schema change process over time. You start out with the YOLO approach down at the bottom there, and people, I don't know if you're familiar with the /EF command, but that allows you to actually edit stored procedures in Postgres interactively and the PSQL command line. So people do that in prod, it's pretty awesome. That's kind of on the Precambrian evolutionary scale. And then over time, people figure out that maybe, you know, they want a little more process involved in their schema management, and they start doing things like using revision control on their schemas. And then eventually, they do things like have rollback plans and code review. And then finally, we sometimes occasionally get to tests that are run using generated data on our schemas. How many of you here do that? Runtesson. Nice. All right. My people here. That's great. And then you might move on to testing on prod-like data, which is exciting. And then finally, you might get to testing a complete stage environment that has a copy of production data. And I will say that I am one of the very fortunate few that has a complete copy of production data in my staging environment. And it makes my life a lot easier. So here to say it can be done. It happens. So what is sane schema management? Well, I think I define that as executing a schema change in a controlled and repeatable way while you're working with developers and also operations. I think that this is the only way that you can get it to be controlled and repeatable is if you have both the developers and the operations folks kind of working together. You know, it's the DevOps keyword, but you really do need people collaborating on this. And the other thing that I've realized as I've had to maintain this system for the last couple years is that migration tools really are configuration management tools for your database. And once that kind of clicks in the head of the people that are working on these problems, in some ways it can make the conversations easier about really how this is managed, why you need code review, and why having downgrade scripts is actually a really good idea. So the stuff we're going to talk about today, migrations, they're about communicating change, communicating process, and like I said, executing stuff in a controlled and repeatable way with both developers and operations. So what you came here for, Alembic, it's a schema migration tool that integrates with SQLAlchemy, and I'm going to get into a lot of details about exactly how to use it in my talk today. So my assumptions about people's environments and why you might want to use something like Alembic specifically is that schema migrations are frequent. Automation of schema migration is a goal. We currently have an environment that runs a downgrade and then an upgrade in Jenkins before every build of our production code. That your stage environment is enough like production for testing. It doesn't have to be an exact duplicate like ours, but it needs to be enough. It needs to have enough bad data in it or whatever else it is that you deal with in production so that it can make it real. And also, I assume that writing a small amount of code is okay. Sometimes this can be a problem if you're working in an environment where you have to hand things off wholesale to the DBAs. I know that Mike wrote the Alembic with that specific situation in mind, and there are tools built into it to help you with that so that you can just hand raw SQL off to a group of DBAs if that's how your environment runs. Yeah, so, but no tool is perfect. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things that I think that Alembic could learn and change, things about it that could change in the future. I really think ultimately DBAs should drive migration tool choice because otherwise they're probably just not going to use it. And it really helps to have a tool that DBAs and developers like. And I have to say, our developers and DBAs both really like Alembic a lot. So here's how the whole talk is organized. First, I'm going to share with you some DBA problems, one specific one that I've had. I'm going to talk a little bit about picking the right migration tool and why Alembic will probably work for you. I'm going to go through basic commands, talk about lessons learned, and then finally some of the things that I think Alembic could learn from my production environment. So I don't know if that's very easy to read, but this is something that I had to do to my database not too long ago. And to just cut to the punchline here, it's kind of a scary bit of PLPGSQL. I basically had to drop and replace about 200 partition constraints that had the wrong constraint on them. They were just using timestamp instead of timestamp with time zone. And this is kind of one of those really horrible, messy DBA problems that comes up that is used as a reason or I would say an excuse about why people don't want to use migration systems. This is one of those hard, messy problems that you may not want to put into your migration system. But I actually used Alembic to run this. And that link there is the code, the actual revision file that's in our production release that has this code in it, and it worked really well. And what sucked about this wasn't the first time that we'd had to deal with this particular issue. and it was a motivating factor for getting Alembic into our environment. The change just sort of snuck in sometime between January and April into the production database. We at the time didn't have any useful audit trail for how that had happened, and some partitions were affected, but not others. And the original error dated back to like 2010. So it was time for us to examine the process of how we were managing our schema, and so I did that. I broke it down, and this is what it looked like. So first of all, we created raw SQL files for each change, and we'd like test it locally on some system we set up on our laptop. We'd copy and edit some template files, recreate the old schema, run a shell script on it, update the migration, on and on and on, you know, commit things. And then one of the worst, most horrifying things that we had to do was test it on stage and then dump the schema out of stage and recommit that back into our production repo. I really wanted to get away from this. It was really frustrating. And oftentimes that step of committing the schema back would get skipped because it was so frustrating to do. And this is our process pretty much now. You know, we create an old schema. We actually use SQLAlchemy to do that with a model.py, create an Alembic revision, test an upgrade, commit the revision to the repo, and that's the last time that we touch the production code. At that point, it's ready to go. So just quickly, yeah, so anyway, it was great. Now we can use Alembic to manage these changes. Experimentation on this particular problem that I had revealed, you know, which partitions could be modified without deadlocking. And we just got to run it a few times over and over again to get the final change rolled out everywhere. And I was able to roll out this partition management change in regular business hours. I didn't have to take a downtime to do it, which for me was pretty amazing. So without the visual, here's the steps to do this process with Alembic. You make the changes to your model.py or maybe raw SQL files. You run Alembic revision dash dash auto generate. You edit the revision file, and then you commit the changes. And we also have another step. We actually run manually the migration on stage after the auto deploy of a release. But another thing that we've just started doing in the last like month is we have Jenkins run the downgrade and upgrade as part of the test suite. And once we're satisfied that that's working well for everyone, we're going to have migrations run automatically on stage and maybe on production. I don't know. It's a little sketchy, but I'm hoping that we get to that point. So yeah, I don't know if these are the same kinds of problems that you guys run into, but we really wanted to have an easy way of including user-defined functions in the migrations for dev and stage. We can embed raw SQL in these migrations. By default, it includes downgrades, which, you know, if you're using South, that's also something that happens there. It really enables database change discipline. This is how I get the developers to review our changes. I send them a Python file that has some SQL embedded in it, and they're much more willing to review it. So now we have a lot of code review discipline in our process. And the revisions themselves are decoupled from release versions and the branch commit order, which I'll talk a little bit more later. The last few problems that it solved for us, I was able to remove 100,000 lines of code. And that was in the form of shell scripts. And I was like the number one contributor for that quarter. It was so great. All deletion. We had no more post-deployment schema check-ins. Oh, God. It's horrible. And now we're deploying this enabled a tested and automated stage deployment. And we've finally separated the schema definition from version-specific configuration, which is incredibly also important for stability. So anyway, this is me, so happy now, it's really great. So if you're in the position of needing to pick a data migration tool, it's sort of a choose your own adventure a little bit. And here are some of the questions that I think it's important to kind of ask about before you dive in to any particular one. First of all, how often does your schema change? Like, if it's almost never, you may not need a tool like Alembic, right? It may just be kind of a waste of your time. Do you need the migrations? Well, do you need the migrations to be run without you? And also, can you have them run without you, individual person that knows a lot about the schema? Are you able to test the migration before you run it in production? Surprisingly, this is not a question that everyone asks before they implement a system. Also, can developers create a new schema without your help? This is incredibly important for us for new contributors, because we have outside contributors contributing code to this business intelligence system that we use for analyzing crashes, and it's kind of amazing, and they really need to be able to do this without me. How hard is it to get from the old schema to the new one? Like, we've got people that have adopted Socorro way, way in the past, like a year ago, and I sometimes need to generate I try to help them generate migrations from ancient versions up to get them up to date. And also, are change rollbacks a standard use of the tool? Some people don't ever roll back. Some people only roll forward. So that's important to know whether you need that or not. So for us, we need to communicate change. We need to apply changes in the right order. We need to apply changes only once. We need to use a lot of raw SQL where needed, because we have a lot of this PLPG SQL code. And we want to provide a single interface for those changes. And finally, I really want us to be able to roll back gracefully. Postgres makes that pretty easy because of the support for transactions, which is really nice. But sometimes, you know, you might need that in another system as well. So, one thing that I struggled with, was that the DBAs were not super excited about what I'm going to say on this next slide. Really hated the idea of using an ORM at all. And what I'll say about that is that before we implemented Alembic, we had three different ways of defining schema in our tests, and they were all used by different parts of the code. And so this was an opportunity to show them how having a central source of truth would be really helpful for maintaining the schema. So this is about having that ORM talk. I don't have a whole lot of time to go over all the details about this, but basically, having a single source of truth really helps a lot of stuff. Then you end up with reusable components and database version independence from the rest of the code. And also this ability to use raw SQL. Some other stuff that we talked a lot about was fitting into the existing tooling, enabling partnership with developers, and integrating in with the testing framework, which is still something that I'm struggling with now, because I inherited this huge amount of code that had no tests. And now we at least have a framework and a few tests, but you know, that's kind of my next large body of work, is implementing complete tests for our database schema. Yeah, anyway, this might help you if you end up having to have that DBA talk. So, on to actually using Alembic. So, I wrote a blog post that walks you through very practically in a narrative style, like how to do this. That was an interesting, thank you, OpenOffice. Alembic has a read.doc site, and the documentation there is really great. It's got a lot of best practices built into it. Some of the vocabulary that you're gonna have to deal with right off the bat that might be different than other migration systems you use, first of all, revision is a single migration. A down revision is the previous migration. Upgrade, actually applying the change. Downgrade, rolling back or downgrading. And then offline mode, which is emitting raw SQL for a particular change, which I'm gonna show you how to run that in a minute. These are all the commands that you need to use to set up Alembic for the first time. It'll create a directory, it's like Alembic slash, and then some stuff underneath there. I use virtualenv for all this stuff, so I put that in there too. And then when you're creating a new revision, you can just say revision, and then you give it a message. I often put our bug numbers in there as well, so I'll say fixes, bug, whatever, and then a message. And then you can use upgrade head, and it's got this nice positional syntax as well, where you can downgrade and you can say -1 or -10 or whatever to upgrade or downgrade. So if you have a schema defined in a model file, you don't have to do this, but you can. You can just import that into your env.py and then Alembic does the right thing. It's really great. If you have helper functions, and I have quite a few of these for dealing with like weird stuff that we have in our schema and also doing things like applying permissions on particular tables for me without having to do a lot of extra work, you can just import that in your m.py as well and make it available. One thing that I've had to do also is, I'm just showing you like a couple of these things to just show you how easy it is to kind of integrate some of the typical DBA tasks in here. But we need to ignore some schema elements that we're not actively maintaining, I should say, in our production database with this particular code base. And so in include symbol, you can put things like ignoring a bunch of partitions. You can see there I've got a regular expression to ignore things that have 8 digits at the end of them, which indicates a database partition. And I'm also ignoring this schema called Bixie, which we're deprecating. Another thing that I've done is I am managing a lot of raw SQL files that have PLPG SQL in them. And I just put a create or replace function in there, and then I just shove the whole file into this directory, and this is how I load them every time. When you first set up a database initially, you need to tell it what revision you're at in your Alembic repo, and so there's a command called stamp that's provided so that you can do that. And so an example of where you might do that is, like, we have a setup DB command, and then at the end of that, we just stamp it with the most recent revision in our system. And then here's the offline mode. What you do is you create your change, you know, like you change your model in some way, and then you say, and then you create your revision file, which we already did, you know, a couple commands back, and then you tell it to upgrade a particular revision. Here's where the positional syntax, you know, the relative syntax where you say like minus one or plus one or something like that doesn't work. You need to use the actual, actual revision ID. And then you just say dash dash SQL, and it will emit raw SQL. Same for downgrade, where you have to give it a range. But it works great. So some of my lessons learned in dealing with implementing this migration system, I always put the migrations in a separate commit from the rest of my schema changes so that if I have to, for some reason, roll back our production code, I still have the migration in the repo. We deploy our production code onto the database the same way we deploy everywhere. So this has really helped make it so that I can roll back. Yeah, so and then when you revert the commit for a general change, you still have the revision file itself. Some people also separate their migration scripts out into a completely separate source controlled repo, and that might work better for you. I try to store the schema objects in the smallest reasonable composable unit. That may mean different things for you. We have a very large schema, as you may have realized when I told you I removed 100,000 lines of code. But we use the ORM for the core schema, and then I put all the types, the user-defined functions, and the views in their own separate SQL files. And like I said, consider storing the schema and the revisions in a separate source-controlled repo if that's appropriate for your environment. If you write tests, run them every time. We wrote a really simple tool to generate a new schema from scratch so that we could run the tests on them. We wrote a simple tool to make fake data for us, and then we also wrote tests for those tools themselves. And that has helped us kind of stay honest with everything. And when things fail in your migration process, write another test. Yeah, anyway, more harping on testing. I just have a couple more minutes, so I just wanted to quickly say, here's some of the stuff that I think would be really helpful to be core functionality in Alembic. One is just understanding database partitions out of the box would be really nice so that I didn't have to add this thing to ignore them. Another thing would be to never apply a default to a new column. So in Postgres, there's a little performance optimization where if you don't apply a default, you don't have to take out as many locks. It doesn't take as long to add a column. It would be nice if Alembic understood that. Help us manage user-defined functions a little better. It's a tall order, but that would be so awesome if there was sort of some established patterns. The pattern that we have of having these separate files works pretty well, but there are some drawbacks to it. Having Alembic understand index concurrently when we're adding indexes would be really nice. Having a little bit prettier syntax for multi-commit sequences, because sometimes I need to do things in a certain order, and I don't want my entire migration to run in a single transaction. It'd be nice if there was a little prettier syntax for that. And finally, this is something that Mike already is aware of and wants to work on and kind of has some stuff out there for, is supporting multiple branches in history. Currently, your history with Alembic just needs to be in a single order, which I understand is different than the Django migration system. And so in the future, that's going to be possible. And I have some ideas for maybe like a sprint thing on Monday for hacking in something, but he's got some great ideas for making this work more holistically in the future. So just to close, I will say in looking at lots of different tools, no particular tool is perfect for all situations. I think Alembic works really well for us because we have a large schema. Our team is really into automation, and we have a really good relationship with our operations team. So that works great for us, and I think that a big part of that was choosing a tool that both the developers and the DBAs could like at the same time. So hopefully this is some food for thought, gives you something to start from. Here's some other tools that I looked at in my course of my research, and I suggest definitely giving them a look if Alembic doesn't seem to fit for your use case. And then here's some resources related to Alembic that I hope are helpful to you. So, thank you.
So if anyone has questions for Selena, we have about 5 minutes for that.
So I think you missed a step in the Choose Your Own Adventure, which is the toolkit you're choosing still maintained? And I wonder if you could suggest possibly techniques for migrating from one migration system to another migration system. I'm not naming any names here, but I need to make a migration.
Well, so when I did this, one thing that Alembic enables is you don't have to have you don't have to start from zero with the tool. So I just dove in and started writing migrations based on what the current defined schema was, and I didn't even bother migrating any of the old stuff, and I just removed it. So it wasn't a requirement from our open source users that we make those migrations work. I don't have a lot of great suggestions. I was talking with someone a couple days ago about what they were planning on doing, and basically they wrote their own tool to translate the old migrations to the new. So, sorry, it's a crappy situation. I mean, my best suggestion is to like ignore it and just move forward. Yeah.
I've got two quick questions for you. One is, you mentioned a tool to generate data. Is that open sourced? Do you have a name for that project?
Oh, yeah. No, I don't know if I can. So my whole thing that we did, it's very specific to us, so I don't know if it would be very helpful, but it might be a good pattern. But the Socorro repo itself, which is just Mozilla, let's see, I'll put up this. So if you go to the Socorro repo, in there, if you search for fakedata.py, Rob Helmer wrote that, and it's a great, first step. We talked about trying to turn it into like a more modularized tool, but we weren't really sure what other people needed. So if you talk to us and tell us like how we could make that better, we could spin it out.
Cool, thanks. And the other question, you touched on how South migrations are sequential. How does Alembic address that? Thanks
they're,
for your talk.
They're sequential in Alembic. There's some plans and an architecture design to make it so that you can have you know, multiple children from one parent. And that's, you know, that's some work that Mike has that's ongoing that he could use some funding for. If anybody's got deep pockets, that would be awesome. But that's the plan moving forward to do that. My idea for like a quick hack is just to create a file that generates conflicts when you try to merge. And so I'm probably gonna hack something like that in for us, because that's kind of the biggest stumbling block for our developers, is they'll commit to migrations at the same time that are unrelated, and then Alembic is like, don't do that, and Jenkins blows up. But that's really the only major operations thing that we need to fix at this point. Yeah.
So you also said that you run migrations during the testing step on your continuous integration server.
Yes.
Database migrations normally take a long time. How do you do that in a reasonable amount of time?
Yeah. The short answer is I use every possible trick in the book that I can to make migrations take out as few locks as possible and to apply the changes as quickly as possible in all situations, regardless of how much data is involved. So that's my quick answer. There's a longer answer, which is very long. But yeah, I just use lots of tricks, and I teach the developers like how to do that stuff. And so I have a presentation that I gave at our last team work week, you know, that was basically lists of tricks to make the migrations run fast.
Unfortunately, that's all we have time for. Let's give Selena a big round of applause, please.
Okay, thanks.